Hi everyone. Today I will explain you one of the algorithms behind the calculation of the likelihood in Monolix. The likelihood estimation task corresponds to this button in the graphical user interface. As a reminder, the likelihood is the probability to observe the data, so the observations present in the dataset, given the estimated population parameters. It is the objective function we use when estimating the population parameters. It is more convenient to use the log likelihood, LL, that is the log of this probability. And it can be decomposed as the sum of the log of the likelihood for each individual, with yi representing the observation for individual I, and theta the population parameters. If you have watched our video on the estimation of the population parameters with SAM, you saw that SAM does not need to calculate the likelihood to find the population parameters that maximizes it. This is why the likelihood is calculated as a separate task. In Monolix, there are two methods to calculate the likelihood, either via linearization, when the toggle use linearization method is on, or via important sampling. Let me explain the key ideas of these two methods with an example. We need to calculate the probability to observe the data for each individual. Depending on the chosen model, the observations can, for instance, be described as being the model prediction, F, plus a residual error term. In this case, the observations follow a normal distribution. The probability density function of a normal distribution is easy to write, but the problem here is that the true individual parameters Ci are unknown. So we have two solutions. Option 1 considers that the true individual parameters are unknown, but they are probably not too far from the EBEs that we can calculate with a dedicated task in Monolix. This is the linearization option, which we'll represent in another video. The second option is to say that if we don't know the true value of the individual parameters, then we can integrate over all possible values. This option is called important sampling, and I will explain how it works. In the integral, we have the joint distribution of the observations and the individual parameters integrated over all possible values. The first step is to use the Bayes theorem to split the joint distribution into the probability to observe the data given the individual parameters and the probability of the individual parameters. In Monolix, these two probabilities have closed form solutions. See the feature of the weak number 111 for more details. But the problem is that an integral is difficult to calculate. So the key idea is to express the integral as an expectation which can be approximated by a mean using a Monte Carlo approach. So we replace the integral by the average of the probability to observe the data given the individual parameters with the individual parameters sampled from their own distribution. P of y given psi represents the probability to observe the data of individual I given a known value of the individual parameters psi. And this is something that is easy to calculate. If we reuse the same example as before, y follows a normal distribution. So psi of y given psi is simply the probability density function of a normal distribution that we write like this. If I know the value of psi, I can easily calculate the model prediction F. We know the data Y from the data set, and A is a residual error parameter that is part of the estimated and known population parameters. So everything here can be calculated. P of psi represents the probability of the individual parameters and corresponds to the distribution in the population. For example, if we have set a log normal distribution for the volume, we can simply sample etas from a normal distribution and calculate the corresponding individual parameter V. We actually perform this step at the same times for all individual parameters, for example, volume, clearance, and Ka, by sampling from a multidimensional normal distribution, and we calculate the corresponding parameters psi. Let's see how this works in practice. Here I have plotted an example of the probability density function P of psi and the PDF psi of y given psi. The first step is to sample values from the probability density function of psi. I have shown the values here at the bottom. Most of the values will be concentrated in the region where psi of psi is high, here. Then, for all samples, we calculate the value of p of y given psi, and we collect these values on this axis here. And finally, we do the average of all these values, and this is an estimate of the likelihood for individual I. If I sample different values, my average will be a bit different too. The variance of my average depends on the number of samples m, the more the better, and on the variance of p of y given psi. In general, we have several parameters, so the sampling is in several dimensions. If I keep the procedure as it is, it will take me many samples to achieve a reasonable accuracy for my average. This is because a small set of parameters here corresponds to large value of p of y given psi that appear here and that influences the average a lot. So the question is, can we reduce this variance to obtain a good estimate with fewer samples? And this is where important sampling kicks in. Let's go back to the integral. The idea is to multiply the denominator and the numerator by a new distribution Q called the proposal distribution. We group the terms like this, and we can again simplify it as an average, where this time the individual parameters are sampled from the proposal distribution, and we average this entire expression. Let's go back to our drawing. Previously, I was sampling from the psi distribution and evaluating psi of y given psi. If we choose q wisely, the q distribution will be somewhere here. And this expression here will be this times this divided by this. It will look like that, for instance. We see that the two curves with the solid lines overlap quite a lot, which was not the case previously with the dotted lines. So thanks to the introduction of the proposal q, I will now sample more important regions more frequently because there is a bigger overlap. I will end up with values in the more narrow range and a more stable average with a lower variance. So it's all about choosing a good proposal distribution Q. Let's see what are the criteria to choose it. First, we want to choose a proposal distribution Q such that the variance of this expression is lower than my initial variance. But there are also additional requirements. It must be easy to sample from the proposal distribution, and it must have a closed form in order to be evaluated. When I do the average, I need to know what is the probability of the samples I have drawn. I could take as a proposal distribution the conditional distribution, so the probability of the individual parameters given the data. Remember that the conditional distribution represents the uncertainty of the individual parameters for each individual, and that the EBEs are the peak of this conditional distribution. You can watch the feature of the week number 86 for more information. If we take the conditional distribution as our proposal, the expression becomes this. Applying again the Bayes theorem, the variance simplifies to the variance of the probability to observe the data. And this does not depend on psi, so its variance is actually zero, which is ideal. Let's see if the two other requirements are also fulfilled. The first one is, it is easy to sample from the conditional distribution using a Markov chain Monte Carlo procedure, and this is exactly what we do in the conditional distribution task. However, for the last requirement, we have a problem, because the conditional distribution has no closed form solution. We cannot evaluate the probability of a sample. We can only plot a histogram if we sample many values. So what we will do is to approximate the conditional distribution that we see here with a gray histogram by a t-distribution. A t-distribution is easy to sample from and easy to evaluate. To adjust the shape of the t-distribution, we will set its mean as being the mean of all the samples from the conditional distribution and its standard deviation to the standard deviation calculated over all the samples of the conditional distribution. And then there is a last setting that is the degrees of freedom that controls the thickness of the tails. And in Monolix, we set it by default to 5. So this way, we have a proposal distribution that is easy to sample from and to evaluate, and which should greatly reduce the variance of our estimate of the likelihood. So when you click on the likelihood task, what happens is that we're going to sample many samples from the t-distribution and evaluate this expression and do the average. And this gives our likelihood estimate. Remember that the t-distribution depends on the mean and standard deviation of the samples obtained during the conditional distribution task. So when you calculate the likelihood via important sampling, it is important to run the conditional distribution task before. And this is what is done by default in Monolix. When you run the likelihood task, Monolix shows up a pop-up window with this type of plot. It shows the likelihood estimate calculated using more and more samples, with this being the final value. Now that we know how important sampling works, we can understand the meaning of the settings that are available via this button here. The first setting is called Monte Carlo size. It corresponds to the number of samples over which we estimate the likelihood. The second setting is the degrees of freedom of the t-distribution. As I said, by default, it's 5. If you set it to a large number, we're going to have thin tails looking similar to a normal distribution. And on the opposite, lower numbers correspond to thicker tails. From our experience, 5 works well, but there is also an option to try several degrees of freedom of a small number of samples and check which one gives the lowest variance. Let's see the impact of these settings on a concrete example. I here have taken an example of a target-mediated drug disposition model. On the left, we can see the convergence of the likelihood with the default settings. It looks quite okay. In the middle, I have set it as optimized, and the algorithm has selected 1 as degrees of freedom, but the result is not really more stable. And on the left, I have set it myself as fixed to 3, and it is slightly better. One can see on the right that the likelihood is stabilizing a bit faster than what we see here or here. Now you have all the information to understand what the likelihood task does. Have a nice week!